Brooke. You can put that away now. It's almost absolutely needs to go. Are you still pouting about that video game?
It wasn't just any video game. All I had to do was put like one more amulet and I would have reached Nirvana.
You would reach Nirvana? The video game? You even know what Nirvana means.
Of course I do. It's the final level of Teen Challenge for your friend.
Do you think the answer was supposed to make me feel bad because you need to have life so I don't think I didn't see that eyebrow. How many times I gotta tell you, I can not know what your skin is.
Yeah.
What is this? One more stop where we need to go.
I don't see why we got this bus anyway.
Like I said, my car's gonna shop me. You guys have time with the other one.
Why couldn't we just call an Uber or a taxi?
Because we weren't paying for it. Or do you have against riding a bus anyways?
I'm not poor people ride the bus. You take the bus when you don't have any other way to get around.
There are millions of people around the world who take public transportation by choice. This is our stop.
Where are we?
We're in a rescue mission.
What's that supposed to mean?
You'll see when you get there.
It's really dark though. Are you sure it's safe for us to be out here?
Yes, as well as the city rescue mission. Read the message.
Oh, hey Nina, glad you could make it.
Yeah, we'll be here early if this was the track.
Mom, there's nothing wrong with my feet.
It's so very wrong. I see you have a lot of help.
Yeah, we have dozens of people that came out. We have working in groups up there.
Well, me and Nick are ready to pitch in.
We can use you to help pull books out the dumpster.
You mean the computer dumpster's over there full of books?
Yeah.
I don't get it. What were they trash?
See, those books, like this one, were part of the community college library. There was some talk about reopening the school. Their first closed over a decade ago, but as you can see, that never happened.
I still don't see why they were thrown away.
Well, despite the student's creditors, Steve's name stole books and such things, like valuable things, like wiring and light fixtures and technical things. This is crazy.
And then a German-based real estate company finally purchased the property and decided they want to raise it for a different type of investment. Matter of fact, we wouldn't even have known the books were still in the building if it had not been for a local homeowner who saw the books to be thrown away.
Yeah, local homeowner posted a picture of five dumpsters on her Facebook page.
Unfortunately, three of the dumpsters were thrown away before we could get the call out to rescue the books. But at least we could save some of them.
Well, me and Brooke are
great. Brooke, you can help my daughter Asha pack the books. Asha, come here.
Yes, sir?
This is Brooke. She's gonna help you pack the books. Can you get it started?
No problem. This is Kimmy, and that's Tommy. Hello. This is Brooke. As you can see, we're sorting the books into three piles. One pile is definitely to be saved, another pile questionable books, and the last pile is to be trashed.
Trash? I thought we were trying to save the books.
Yeah, some of the books lost their value. Things like encyclopedias and textbooks don't do anyone too much good anymore. But we're definitely keeping like the classics and autobiographies and stuff. Ready to get started?
Sure. Where are the work gloves?
Do you see anybody with work gloves here?
That's because they're not available.
Stop smiling, Bridget. It's a word.
Actually, it's Brooke, not Bridget.
Same difference.
Don't pay them any attention. You go with me and also the books in this cart, okay? Yeah, you'll find lots of books like that. Just do what you can to try to save as many as you can, okay?
Stop stalling. Didn't you hear Asher say? It's gonna rain later, so we're trying to save as many books as possible. Where do you go anyway? Home for the pillows or grocery store?
If it's any of your business, I live in Detroit.
Really?
But I'm sure you don't go to school in Detroit, so are you a student at Detroit Country Day or the Roper School?
Not sure, Asher. She looks more like a Bloomfield Hills girl to me.
How do you know I don't go to school too?
Don't pay them any attention, Brooke. I'm at a school in Rochester Hills, and I don't have a problem letting anyone know it. Even my cousin Kim, the cash tag snob.
A snob? I would imagine what I would have to be so proud about. Maybe because such notables graduated there, like Ed Gordon, George Cushingberry, John DeLorean, Jack White.
Why did you get her started? Listen, Brooke, we're just giving you the business. We're just glad you came with us.
Pay for yourself.
Well, I'm glad to help
you
get up
kids. Ghetto kids? Who talks like that? Do they not use books where you go to school? Or wait, maybe you're homeschooled and all you get is random worksheets your mom prints on the internet.
Okay, whoa, unfair stereotype. But no, I'm not homeschooled. I go to
that explains it.
Consulting me doesn't change the fact I'm probably wasting my time.
What do you think that?
I'm sure most books are probably digitalized anyways. Most people are probably easier to download these books at home than computers at
home. You don't really live in Detroit, do you?
Yeah, and look, everything is digitalized. My father told me that there are resources here that you can't find anywhere else.
Besides, not everyone in the city has access to a computer or a tablet. And even if they did, they don't have access to the internet.
It's not just that either. It's not just a problem for random people like you or me. It's a problem for lots of people, whether they live in the rural areas or the city.
Then go to the library.
Oh, like this one that's closed down?
Then go to the library.
Oh, yeah, like the one that's down the street from me that got shut down to save money.
Okay, it's a problem for a lot of people. But I still don't see why saving these books are so important. Unless you plan to sell them to raise money for the community.
Well, it's people who just access.
I know this may be a shock to you young people who think thousands of years of history and culture are at our fingertips, but everything is digitalized.
Yeah, and it's sad that they can throw away such valuables. That's why we have to gather up and save them.
City's burning by Devil Grammar. Never heard of it. Listen to the book. I don't know what there was about the slender volume which caught my eye, but as I held it in my hands, it felt special, so I set it aside. After we finished stacking as many books as we could for the night, I asked Mom if we could borrow the book for a while.
Sure you can. It's a library book.
Now, I can't tell you the last time I read a book before going to bed, but when I got home that night, I couldn't stop reading the poem. For some reason I could not explain, this book, it speaks to me. There's a poem about being a black man.
Black girl, lips as curved as cherries, full as grape bunches, as sweet as blackberries. Black girl, when you walk, you are as magic as a rising bird or a falling star. Black girl, what's the spell to make the heart in my breast jump, stop, shake?
Another spoke of summer days on Belle Isle.
When the leaves were the color of the sun, and the island floated toward winter, you exclaimed at the brighter surging past. You reached for words to express their masterful glide. You laughed at the insolent motorboats, hurling their foaming wake upon the shore, delighted in the blue-celled vessel and in the flower house. You were ecstatic at the firmament of the bell-like flowers. You reached on tiptoe to still blossom. You pinched the stem. To go by love, you said. You listened to the tinkle of the carousel, mixing your laughter with his melody, and food and drink and cigarettes were part. But I, watching, thought, this is how poets are. This is the inner principle of their art. Joy in the light. Poems conceived in joy, endowing the world in time forever. Joy in the light.
Another spoke of a black heritage some people seem reluctant to embrace.
Why are our ancestors always kings and princes and never common people? Was the old country a democracy? Or did the slave catchers only steal the aristocrats and left behind the laborers, cleaners, dishwashers, cooks, maids behind? My own ancestor, research revealed, was a swineherd who tended the pigs and in the royal pigsty and slept in the mud among the hogs. And I am as proud of him as of any king or prince. Dream up in fantasies of bygone glory.
Another lampoon the concept of the melting pot.
There is a melting pot, where any girl or man can step in Czech, Greek, or Scot, and step out American. Johan and Jean, Juan, Giovanni, and Ivan all step in and step out again, freshly christened John. So Sam, watching, said, well, I was here even before they came and tried to step in, but was tossed out before it even passed the brim. And every single time Sam tried to get into that magic melting pot, he was tossed out. Keep out. Your kind is not allowed here. We don't want your black stain. And after a while, Sam said one thing, one phrase. I don't give a damn. You can like it or not, but I'll be just what I am.
Another spoke of the roots of the Black Power. The revolution did not begin in 1966 when Stokely raised his fist and shouted, Black Power. Nor did it begin last year when you ran Fannin and discovered you were black. The revolution was going on when the first black leaped overboard to the sharks, when blacks malingered or sabotaged a plantation, or time to outwit old master. When your father, whom you deplore, pushed a broom, and your mother, whom you despise, scrubbed kitchens, so you could go to school and read Fannin. Did not begin in 1966 when Stokely raised his fist and shouted, Black Power! Nor did it begin last year when you read Fannin and discovered you were black.
The next morning, I was so excited about Mr. Randall's poems, I decided to share one of them with one of my teachers.
Read a poem? In this class?
Yes, Ms. Campos, a poem by Dudley Randall. Dudley Randall, you gotta know who he is.
Fresh my memory.
Here, let me show you. Oh, you got that type.
You know, I really don't allow phones in my classroom.
This is second Miss Campbell, so I'm trying to flip this.
Hey, how many times have I told you stop bringing that fidget to my class?
Sorry.
Okay. Now, what is it? In 1914, he was born in Washington, D.C., but his family moved to Detroit when he was very young. After working at a Ford plant, the post office, and serving in the military, he earned a Bachelor of Arts degree from Wayne State University and a Master's of Library Science from the University of Michigan. He then became a librarian.
A librarian who wrote poetry? Well, there's nothing special about that. I have a cousin who has a blog who features a poetry. She's written one every day for the last 3 years.
Ms. Campbell, I'm not talking about poetry. I'm talking about quality and influence. Mr. Randall's writing received so much recognition. He received international recognition in 1981. He was named Poet Laureate of Detroit.
Poet Laureate of Detroit?
Yes, it does sound enough. He made me better known as the founder of the Broadside Press. In 1965, this Detroit-based press became world-renowned for publishing works by such writers as Gwendolyn Brooks, Margaret Walker, Kathy Mahaluli, Sonia Sanchez, Nikki Giovanni, and Etheridge Knight. From what I'm reading here, Dudley Randall is considered one of the most important public figures of the civil rights movement.
Oh, bro, this is highly impressive, but this is a history class. Why don't you bring the poem to the attention of your English teacher?
Ms. Campos, we're the last one to be studying the 20th century civil rights movement, right?
Right.
Well, this poem is related to what we've been learning because it discusses one of the most atrocious crimes of that era, the 1963 church bombing that left four girls dead. We're attending Sunday school.
But we covered the incident yesterday.
Ms. Campos, aren't you the teacher who's always talking about how we should review what we learned? Shouldn't this poem be used as an important discussion?
Okay, fine. You can open with your poem when the bell rings.
Thank you. The Ballad of Birmingham by Dudley Randall.
Mother dear, may I go downtown instead of out to play and march the streets of Birmingham in a freedom march today?
No, baby, no. You may not go, for those dogs are fierce and wild, and guns and hoses, clubs and jails aren't good for a little child.
But mother dear, I won't be alone. Other children will go with me and march the streets of Birmingham to make our country free.
No, baby, no. You may not go, for our fear those guns will fire. But you may go to church instead and
sing in the children's choir. She combed her night dark hair and bathed rose petals sweet. She drew white gloves on her hands and small shoes on her feet.
The mother smiled to know that her child was in a sacred place, but that smile was the last smile to come upon her face. For when she heard the explosion, her eyes grew wet and wild. She raced the streets of Birmingham, calling for her child. She clawed through bits of glass and brick, and then pulled out a shoe. Oh, here's the shoe my baby wore. But baby, where are you?
Class, what is the subject of this poem?
The Birmingham Bombing.
Let's go beyond the poem's title, Kendra.
It was about the love a mother has for her child.
Yeah, he's right. My mother's always trying to protect me. I guess she just wants me to be safe.
Well, the motherly concern is certainly universal.
But it wasn't enough.
What wasn't enough?
The love she had for her child couldn't keep her from mom.
What was needed?
She needed to keep her daughter at home. That's why some parents homeschool their kids.
No, that's wrong. Just because you're at home, that doesn't mean you're safe. See, remember when... Oh, not the bell yet, it's the first lunch bell. But remember when civil rights leader Edgar Evers was killed at home? It wasn't until the laws, the citizens, and the government banded together to put an end to racial violence.
Right, a little shaky there, but good job.
So guys, let's review how ordinary citizens plus the three branches of government fought to address this issue.
You look like a Cheshire Cat.
I'm sorry, what?
A Cheshire Cat. You know, from Alice in Wonderland?
Are you talking about the classic or the Tim Burton? Because I remember when the movie came out, you wouldn't take me to see it.
I'm talking about the classic from Lewis Carroll.
Lewis who?
That's okay, that's another topic. But anyway, since you're so obsessed with Mr. Random, I thought I'd watch you this poetry.
Roses and Revolutions. The selected writings of Dudley Randall. From here, the best.
Now, where's my iPhone? What was that, Instabam or Snapchat?
Instabubble? Snapchat? Are you serious, Mom? For the next few days, I spent my free time savoring and working with Mr. Randall. But there was something else about the book my mom bought me that set my imagination soaring. It was a short story entitled Victoria. The words Mr. Randall used to tell the story were so vivid, I could see the tale played out in my mind's eye.
David was happy. He was waiting for Victoria to ask her a question. And if she gave him the answer he expected, he would be happier still. David had played out in the schoolyard all afternoon, and when he had enough of play, he came up to his den in the attic.
David's den was at the end of the attic next to the one small window level of the floor. His desk was an old army blanket on the floor, and his bookcase was an old crate that was filled with his books and notebooks. Outside of David's window overlooked the playground, which extended from his backyard to the school, about a block down. When David opened the window, he let in the freshness of the April afternoon and the children playing on the playground.
David glanced, wandered over the field, flooded with sunshine. A group of boys and a group of girls were playing baseball. A smaller children were climbing the horizontal bars of supports for the swings. Near the alley, some older boys were playing dice with one on the lookout for roaches. The bright shirts and dresses, the movements of ball players, the crack on the bats of the balls, and the shouts of the players made the field a world of color, motion, and sound.
David projected himself into the scene. He was striking the ball, he was running the bases. He was crouched in the corner of the dice and talking to them and caressing them like a lover.
While David was immersed in these actions, he became aware of a self that stood aloof and watching him. And if yet, another self that stood there watching him watch himself, like a series of mirrors.
David didn't see Victoria on the playground, so he began to write in his notebook. In his 17th year, he first saw her and fell in love with her. She was out playing with the other girls on the playground, but she was the only one he saw. She outhit, outran, and outlaughed them all. She was tall and lithe and shapely. Her arms and legs were bare, darkened to the color bronze by the sun. Her voice was the sound of silver.
That was how he first saw Victoria. He learned her name from his friends and asked his big sister about her. Are you carrying a torch to Victoria? What do you see in her? She's boxing a walnut.
She has big eyes and pretty legs. David, pay no attention to Rachel. She was only laughing at him because he was interested in the girls that she tried to pair him with and whom he was never interested in.
I told my brother Victoria was an orphan. She lived with her uncle and her aunt, made her do all the housework. Let her come and go as she pleased. She was done with her work.
David learned so much about Victoria before he even met her. One day, as he was walking down the street with his eyes cast down to avoid stumbling over the level pavement, he came across a pair of small feet, and then a pair of brown legs. He did not know whose they were, but there was something so familiar and exciting about them.
Looking up, he saw Victoria coming toward him. There was not one whom he would rather have met, and he began thinking of ways to avoid her. He looked about wildly, but he passed the alley and had not reached the cross street. He could turn into a doorway, cross the other side of the street, and that would be too obvious. He could pass her without speaking. That was rude. But if he spoke to her first, would she answer him? Now she was upon him. What could he do?
Hey, David.
David had reached his hand out if to say something and stammered, "Hello." After she passed, David leant up against the wall until he was able to walk again.
After that, he would speak to her whenever they met. He made no attempt to seek her out or to go places where she might be. He was content with an occasional meetings, and they made his days rich and adventurous. Who could tell when they would meet? He would speak to her, she would smile, and he would utter.
Always the same thing happened to him. The blood rushed to his face, his knees grew weak. He became dizzy and could hardly speak. He would make his way home, giddy and excited, and write an account of the meeting.
About this time, David became interested in Dante's love portrait in The New Life. It explained his feelings perfectly. Dante's chance meetings with Beatrice and his adoration for her were similar to, I don't know, David's encounters with Victoria and his love for her. He read them incessantly and learned The New Life almost entirely by heart. He even went out and bought a book of Italian grammar and a book of Italian poetry and read Dante's love poetry in the original.
My lady looks so gentle and so pure when yielding salutation, by the way, that the tongue trembles and has not to say. And the eyes, which fain would see, may not endure, and still, amid the praise she hears secure, she walks with humbleness for her array, seeming a creature sent from heaven to stay on earth and show a miracle made sure. She is so pleasant in the eyes of men that through the sight the inmost heart doth gain a sweetness which needs proof to know it by. And from between her lips there seems to move a soothing essence that is full of love, saying forever to the spirit.
Things might have gone on like this indefinitely if he had not a talk with Ned Adams at a local community center, where David was learning how to box. Ned was older than David, about 20.
Man, you are awesome as hell! You are strong, and you are so good! Man, why don't you train regular? In about a year or two, you become one hell of a fighter. Man.
That he had not had time to adjust to it. He was not sure what to do, but he vaguely imagined that sometime in the future, Victoria would be his girl. Now he began to think of some practical means of winning her. He made up his mind that The next time he'd meet her, instead of merely saying hello, he would stop and talk with her and get to learn her. The very next day, he walked to Mr. Siegel's drugstore. He saw her standing by the counter. He was totally unprepared for the meeting. At least when he met her on the street, he had 10 seconds of preparation before speaking to her. Now he was totally surprised. He could hardly stand, so he dropped on the stool next to the soda fountain. Victoria smiled and thinking of things to say. He forgot to say anything.
So David, what will it be?
I'll take a soda. Won't you have one with me?
I just have one.
It's hard to think.
But I wouldn't mind another one.
All right, second.
She sat down by his side. They began to talk of school and neighborhood events. David had often someday dreamed of talking to wise men and poets, but even in his imagination, those conversations were not as exciting as an old Victoria. She was easy to talk with, and gradually David became outwardly calm. But all the while, the air seemed shaking to music, organ, or full orchestra, to which his heart, blood, and pulse danced brightly.
He never knew what they said, but he noticed how long, black and curly her hair was, how it poured upon her shoulders. Her eyebrows were straight and thick, lashes long and glossy. Her eyes were large and soft, with her nose delicately chiseled. Her skin was color-covered, and her cheeks suffused with red. Had the gentle curves of a child's. After she finished the soda, she said,
"Thanks for the soda. I enjoyed it."
David noticed the way her waist tapered from her shoulders. He sat with his head on his hands, thinking,
"Man, David, does anything ever hurt you?"
David stared up without a word and walked out. From that moment on, David lived in that memory of that moment. But then he began to miss Victoria. He looked down the schoolyard but didn't see her. He even passed her house, but she wasn't there.
David, why are you sitting in the window looking half dead? Reading those silly books. Holy Pete, if you like Victoria, why don't you just go out and get her? Instead of mooning in front of the window.
She never invited me to her house. What am I supposed to do?
I wouldn't invite you to my house either if I were Victoria. By the way, why don't you get rid of those sloppy pants and that sweatshirt and put on a shirt and tie and then get some simple outfit.
Is that what those overdressed dimwits that come see you are supposed to have?
At least they're more polished than you, my shabby bookworm. But listen to me, I'm trying to help you. If you want Victoria to be yours, you gotta go out and get her. Faint heart never won, fair lady. Why don't you find her out somewhere?
Well, where can I take her?
There's lots of places, like movies, picnics. I know just the thing. My club's holding a dance next month. I'll invite you. You can invite you that. I'll give you an invitation.
Thanks, but no, I can't dance.
I'll teach you. Come on, you have weeks to learn. Let's get busy right away. There's one more way. We'll invite you. Relax, let yourself go, and don't be so rude.
Clouds and the way they beautifully reflected off the rooftops of the houses nearby. This inspired David to open his journal and write one of Dante's love sonnets.
How wonderfully Dante described Beatrice and the way he felt about her. How wonderfully that the description fitted his own girl himself and himself so perfectly. The poem seemed to be not Dante talking about Beatrice, but himself speaking of Victoria. He would translate it, he would put it into English so he could read it. At the dance, maybe he would show it to him. He turned to a blank page and began to write.
Which renders noble what she looks on.
How true is that about Victoria? She was truly so kind and so beautiful. But the first line of a sonnet is always the easiest. Now, it's time for the second.
By which she makes noble what she gives to.
How true was that line, also? For whenever he saw Victoria, he felt cleaner and finer. And just as Dante had written the divine comedy for Beatrice, he would write a great poem for Victoria someday. The second line of the poem was generally easy. The third line was where the rhymes and difficulty began.
Where she passes, all men turn their look on her.
That was exactly what happened whenever Victoria walked down the street. For David was not the only one she attracted. Whenever she passed, slim and graceful with her long black hair hanging over her shoulders, he had seen men turn around and draw their breath in. But that line would fit with the other preceding lines.
Her eyes, my lady bears love, by which she makes noble what she gazes on. Where she passes, all men turn their look on her. And she makes the heart tremble in him she greets, so that, all pale, he lowers his eyes and sighs. Then, all over his failings, anger and pride fleeing before her. Help me, ladies, to do her honor. All sweetness, all humble thought, are born in the heart of him who hears her speak, and he who first saw her is truly blessed. How she looks. She smiles a little, cannot be spoken of or held in mind. She is so rare, a miracle.
The thought of her walking down the street reminded David that this is about the time she came to the playground. He glanced out the window.
She was there. She wore a white dress like a nurse's, which fit snugly at the waist. She was playing catch with another girl. Two boys stood nearby watching. Now and then they said something, and they all would laugh. She missed the ball and picked it up herself. He grabbed her around the waist, but she twisted smoothly away from him.
That was one thing David liked about her. She did not allow anyone to take liberties with her. Even when the boys tried to do her favors because she was a girl, she refused to accept them, but kept herself in a position of equality with him. She was popular with all the boys and with girls also.
Everything David noticed about her made him like her even more. And since he stumbled on every curb and flight of stairs, he was ashamed to look in mirrors, and everything he made anything to say, he liked her all the more because she was friendly and gentle.
Now he would go ask her to the dance. Now was the time, and she would consent. But he paused for a moment. What if she declined? David had never thought anything but that she would accept. The thought of failure made a cold sweat come on his brow. He had better wait a moment to think it over. David sat down to write in her journal again.
How clean and fresh she looked. And the museum was a torso of a Greek girl, which he loved. The torso had a white marble that seemed to be warm to the touch. Victoria reminded him of this Greek torso, but it saw no difference. She had not the antique Greek lines. She could not be expressed in cold white marble. She was a statue, bronze. A warm, broad bronze. Seems to be sleek to his fingers.
His attention was diverted to the schoolyard by a sudden movement. One figure split from the knot of gamblers and walked down to the far end of the yard. They recognized him as Ned Adams. Ned wore a plaid shirt and blue jeans. He was stocky and bare-chested, but moved easily and lightly. Ned Adams was also a boxer, a flyweight, Ned Adams swaggered across the playground. Boys greeted him and girls turned and looked into his face. But the frighteners did not notice. They stopped a few feet from Victoria.
Ned stared straight at her. She stared into his eyes. She dropped the ball. He picked it up. He handed it to her. She smiled.
It was growing darker, the air deepened from rose to violet. One by one, or in small groups, the girls and boys went home. The cries and laughter faded away to the shadows.
David was trembling.
He hated Ned.
He hated Victoria.
He would fight Ned.
He would punch him into ribbons.
Victoria, why have you betrayed me? You are no good. You are cheap. You are easy. No. Why blame Victoria? This is your fault. You're the fool. What made you think you could have her? What made you think she was yours? How can you compete against Ned?
The book of poetry, which he'd been clutching, slipped from his hand. He picked up the book. He flung down the book with a sob. It was black dark now, too dark to read.
Hey, Brooke, are you still up? How about your dad today? It's okay.
Mama, you all right?
Yeah, I'm just starting to sound like Mama on the bridge.
That's okay.
It's getting late anyway. I'm going to go to bed too. But I'll tell you, this book's got me thinking.
Well, that's the way I like to hear you talk. Think about what?
It seems like there's so much negativity around about Detroit. You know, on TV, movies, or that ruin porn fun on the internet.
Ruin what?
Ruin porn? You know, the talk of
the history has festered here, and bigotry and fear filled the streets with strife and raised the barricade.
Wealth of a city lies not in its factories, its marts and towers crowding to the sky, but in its people who possess grace to imbue their lives with beauty, wisdom, charity.
You have those too long hid, who built pyramids, who searched the skies and mapped the planet's range, who sang the songs of grief that made the whole world weep, whose Douglas, Malcolm, Martin, from exchange.
The Indian with his soul, attuned to nature's role, the sons and daughters of Cervantes smile, and introduce children to, and trust their fate to you, souls forged by Homer, Dante, Shakespeare, Goethe, Yeats, Stein.
Together we will build a city that will yield to all hopes and dreams so long deferred. New faces will appear, too long neglected here.
New minds will mean to build a brave new world.